Mormon Stories Podcast is a production of the Open Stories Foundation. All donations to Mormon Stories are fully tax deductible and go directly towards keeping the podcast alive and towards building a community of support for Mormons like you. Hello and welcome to another edition of Mormon Stories Podcast. I'm your host, John DeLynn. It's very exciting to have you with us today, both in audio and for those of you joining us on YouTube in video. It is July 29th, 2015. We're broadcasting or recording today from Salt Lake City, Utah in Sugar House. And we're just very, very excited to have with us today a really important emerging voice in progressive Mormonism. Her name is Julienna Viegas-Haws. She is super cool and interesting for a number of reasons. She's from Belgium. It's sort of important to note in a time when race is really an important issue to be discussed nationally and internationally. It's worth noting that Julienna is a person of color. We'll be talking about that. She's also European. She was raised in Belgium. She speaks French as her native language, but she also speaks English fluently and a few other languages in addition to some degree or another. She is most known in 2015 for a really important op-ed that she wrote in the Salt Lake Tribune. The op-ed is called, What Do Progressive Mormons Want? A Dialogue About Change. And it's really struck a nerve on Facebook and on Twitter and on the internet. And so we're going to be talking about that in depth today, about her views. But most importantly, we're going to talk about her story, which includes, again, being raised in Europe, in Belgium. It includes being raised as a person of color within the LDS Church in Europe. It'll talk about her experience as a missionary on Temple Square here in Salt Lake City, Utah. She is married to a Caucasian, you know, LDS church member. So she's in an interracial marriage. We'll be talking about that. And then also we're going to talk about sort of her faith journey that aligns with her family. And then we're going to talk about this article and her views on the church in the 21st century and, her thoughts on what might need to happen to help make Mormonism healthier and better. And so I just can't say I'm excited enough to have you today, Julienna Viegas-Haws, to Mormon Stories. Welcome.
Well, thank you. thank you very much. I'm happy to be here. I am excited to do this.
And a little nervous.
And a little nervous.
Well, you've got a great
I'll
story.
I'll relax as it goes.
Yeah. Well, we'll get you talking. You'll be fine. Thanks for joining us. And let's just begin. Tell us a bit about your parents and how your family sort of ended up in Belgium.
Okay. So my mother is half Portuguese father and Congolese mother. So her dad ended up in the Congo as an entrepreneur, as a businessman. So he went over there and bought some land. And
around what year?
That is in the 1930s.
Okay.
Actually, before that, 1920s, because my mom was born in 1937.
Okay.
So I would say really early 20th century. And so I think he married he didn't marry my grandmother, actually, but he wanted to be with her. I think he liked her, but mostly so he could get access to the land. So that's a little bit how they worked back then. You know, the Europeans go and they try to get into the communities. And so he met my grandmother and had good favor with her father, who was a colonel in the Belgian army, which at the time the Congo is a Belgian colony. So my mother is born in the Congo. She had a very privileged life living there. They had servants. She was homeschooled. they didn't interact a lot with the people on the outside, except for hires. They would, you know, work on the land and work in the house. I mean, they had cooks and just servants, all sorts of people helping out in the house. So that's my mother. She at around...
So her mother didn't marry her father?
Yes. And okay. The reason is...
Did he have other, you know, spouses or...
You know, we don't know for sure, but we think so. Okay. My mother doesn't really know. If it happened, it was secretive and she doesn't know about it. But she thinks it may have happened. But the reason why they're not married is because he wants to take hold, I mean, to keep the assets. And he wants to choose which children will have access to it. My father bears her father's name. So my last name, my maiden last name is Lopez Ferreira Viegas, which is the Portuguese name of my mother, which is the name of her father.
Interesting.
So, yes, and she was apparently favored of her father out of the five children they had, my grandparents. My mom says that she was the favorite. She always says that her father just loved her, you know, to pieces, and I don't know that it's a good thing to have favorites among your children, but that's how she feels.
Okay.
So
what language did she grow up speaking?
She grew up speaking French and also Lingala, which is the native language of her mother.
Why French?
Why French? Because it's a Belgian colony and people speak French. I mean,
okay.
Yeah, I don't know. And she knew Portuguese too with her father. As a little girl, she spoke Portuguese with her father. She okay. said that too. But French was like the schooling language
okay.
over there.
Got it.
Yep.
Okay, so your mother spoke French, was one of five children
mm-hmm.
to a Portuguese father.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And a Congolese mother.
Okay. Yes. And so, and kind of a growing up with privilege.
Yes. Like a little princess.
Like a little princess. Okay.
Different for me.
And how did she end up in Belgium?
Okay, so how does she end up in Belgium? So... So the Congo is a
Belgian... And a member of the church.
And a member of the church.
Yeah.
So the Congo is a Belgian colony, so there is a lot of Belgians in the Congo. And around 20 years old, she goes and works for the radio, like a local radio, and meets her first husband, who is a Belgian. And they fall in love, and she, you know, they want to get married. He asks my grandfather, and it is granted. So... they get married. I think they flew to Belgium and got married in Belgium. And go on and have three kids, three boys. And after, I don't know exactly how many years, but after maybe 10 years, they get divorced in Belgium. And then, no, it had to be less than 10 years, maybe... I don't know the exact dates, but they end up getting divorced. So my mom is a single mom with three boys. And then 10 years later, she meets my father, who is a Congolese. Okay. So she meets the white guy in Africa and the black guy in Belgium. It's all reversed.
Who's from Congo?
Who's from the Congo.
Yeah.
And there is a lot of exchange because of the colony, you know, there is a lot of back and forth between Congolese going to Belgium and Belgians going to the Congo. So it's, right. I would say that it's one of the minorities, you know, in Belgium would be the Congolese.
Okay, so let me see if I get this right.
Yes.
So your mother was biracial.
Yes.
Right? Your mother's first husband was from Belgium.
Correct.
So he was Caucasian.
Yes.
And then your mother's second husband was from the Congo.
Correct.
And so then she had...
my sister and I.
Okay.
Yes.
Great. All right.
With the second marriage. So first marriage, three boys, and then 10 years later, married to my father and have my sister and I. That marriage didn't last very long either because there were a lot of conflicts with my older brothers and the new father. And my mom was also 10 years older than my father. And the family didn't quite accept the union. And so lots of conflicts. I have very little memories. My parents divorced when I was 2 years old. And I think there was cheating involved on the side of my dad. And my mom pretty much kicked him out and wanted nothing to do with him at all, even forbade him to see us. And she kind of put the whole family in this situation where do not approach him, do not let him approach, you know, us. And I know he tried for some time to be in contact with us, but she did everything she could that so it wouldn't happen. So
your biological father wasn't an active part of your life?
No.
Okay.
Up until about 6 weeks ago.
Okay. Let's hold on that. We'll come back.
Yes. To that. That's a whole other story that maybe may not belong here, but
okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Did you know your grandparents?
I did not know any of my grandparents.
Either your, okay.
On my mom's side or
okay.
Obviously my dad's side. I know no one on that side of the family.
And how did your mother earn a living when she was living in Belgium as a single mom?
When my mother first came to Belgium, she received her allowance, right, from her wealthy father. So she basically had enough to live off from without having to work. And
that's nice.
That's very nice. And so she kept, you know, living, I guess, the grand life when she went to Belgium. But things took a different turn after, well, so we have to go back a little bit. In 1973, my grandfather passes away, and he had left a few instructions on how, you know, to give the money out or whatnot. And she received her portion of the money. And so she still had enough to live on. So like when my brothers are young and, you know, with the first marriage, everything financially, everything is fine. But then when she marries my father, whom she helps with his studies, she basically pays for his studies. And she tries to get involved in a business, like a restaurant type thing and kind of a club or something. And she ends up losing all of her money. Mm. She's embezzled. She partners with some people who took advantage of her because she wasn't really financially savvy. Like she didn't really know what she was doing. So she loses everything and is poor. So I grew up, you know, with really not much at all. And so she doesn't really have an education. She doesn't have any degree in anything. So she was a hairdresser for a while. She was a nurse assistant for a while. Like she tried to do whatever she can. But from that moment on, even with my brother, she's pretty much a single mother the whole time. So I grew up with her as a single mother, always working because she always tried to do something and provide for the family, but it was difficult. It wasn't easy. And for her, it was also a shock because, you know, she grew up having everything pretty much given to her. And here she is in the situation where, you know, she has to provide. And so, and she's very courageous. I mean, she's a very brave woman and she worked really, really hard her whole life so that we could be, you know, we could have what we needed. So
I would think that'd be incredibly hard to be raised with so much privilege, almost as like a trust fund kind of child. And then all of a sudden to be poor.
Absolutely.
Not in your home country.
Yes.
And to be raising five children, two divorces with no other support. That would be devastatingly hard.
It was very hard. I mean, luckily, the social system in Belgium is so that she always got a little help from the government. So we always had something. But it was definitely a shock. And what's interesting with my mom is that, you know, from that point on, and I'm very little, so that's the only thing I've known. My brothers have known her, you know, having everything. And, you know, they had multiple cars and all sorts of things. But we never knew that, like my sister and I. We've always known the struggle. But, and it's at that point that after the second divorce, after she loses everything, she is completely depressed. I mean, of course, you know, she doesn't know what she's going to do. She's like, here I am, you know, my business is gone. I have no money. I'm a single mother again. I think the same kind of thing happened with the first husband, where he traveled a lot for work and stuff happened in the Congo and she just left. I mean, they got divorced. But so at that point, she's super depressed. I mean, to the point where I remember, you know, I'm about 3 years old and we live in this apartment. And she really was about to like turn on the gas and let us all like sleep forever. That's how she tells the story. And so she's in this deep, deep depression. And a couple of days, you know, into that, where she's really thinking about it, the missionaries knock at her door. So here...
What's the year?
This is 1980-ish. Okay. No, not ish. 1980.
Okay.
Because she was baptized in 1981.
Okay.
So the missionaries knock at her door, and she's always been a believer. I mean, she wasn't raised a certain religion. I think Catholicism was there, but they were not churchgoers or anything like that. They prayed at home, but not really churchgoers. But she always had faith. I remember she always read her Bible, and you know, she was kind of a seeker. Like, she went to the Jehovah's Witnesses for a while and then didn't feel comfortable. So the missionaries knock at her door, and they're like, you know, hello, we're the missionaries from the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Do you know who we are? She's like, no, I never heard of you. And we have a very important message. You know, can we come in? And she's like, sure, why not? And so they have that little discussion with her, you know, and leave a Book of Mormon with her at the house and say, just, you know, read it. And then, you know, we'll come back in a couple of days. Tell us what you thought. And up until then, my mom is, you know, she drinks, she smokes. That's just part of her life. And she tells about this story that is like, for her, the foundation of her testimony, where she sits on the couch, you know, one afternoon, my sister and I are in school, at school, and she just takes her glass of beer and her cigarettes, and she takes the Book of Mormon and wants to read it. And then she starts telling herself, you know, I'm really annoyed. Like, why am I drinking? Why am I smoking? I'm wasting my time. I'm just, you know, I don't have any money. And here I am, you know, buying this beer and these cigarettes that cost a lot of money. And she just decides on the spot to quit smoking and drinking. And she goes and dumps all the alcohol in the sink and throws the cigarettes away. And so the next time the missionaries come, she's like, you know, I did something really great. I stopped drinking and I stopped smoking this week. And the missionaries are like, do you know Mormons don't smoke and drink? She's like, I never heard of Mormon. And no, I don't know that. And so to them, it was like, whoa, you know, there is power in that book, you know, and how come this happened? And they... both parties, you know, the missionaries and my mom, concluded that there has to be some kind of divine intervention here, because, you know, call it coincidence if you want, but, you know, I quit smoking and drinking, you gave me the Book of Mormon, you guys don't smoke and drink, you know, like, they really saw it as a divine intervention. And that's where her testimony starts. And and ever since, she's been, you know, embracing the gospel. Also, when they taught her about the fact that the church had a prophet and 12 apostles, it just resonated with her, because in all of the other churches, they had never talked about these things. And the whole restoration concept really resonated with her. And she was like, yeah, it makes sense. You know, if they were prophets in the old days, they should be a prophet today. And apostle, it makes sense. And she really embraced the message, and it really resonated with her. So, and at that point, I'm 4 years old. So she joins the church, she's baptized. And in fact, later when we talk about the op-ed, the missionaries who baptized her found me through that and got in contact with me recently, but we can...
Okay.
Later.
Okay. Cool. All right.
So that's how it starts.
So you're four. She joins the church.
Mm-hmm.
And tell us about your upbringing in the church in Belgium.
In Belgium. So when I've loved going to church ever, since, you know, this started. I mean, it was kind of a trek. We would wake up like super early in the morning and travel for an hour in like buses and trams to get to the church building. But my mom would just drag us, you know, with her and do it. And I loved primary. I loved young women's. I mean, I had great experiences. I think I've always been drawn to spirituality, so it came easily for me to just accept everything, and it was pleasant. I feel like the church kind of filled the void, you know, without having a father at home. Like, I had a lot of good, I guess, father figure in the church, or seeing how a home should be like, or, you know, the family that, you know, the church encourages to have with, you know. I didn't have that at home, but I could see it at church, and I wanted that for myself too, for later. And so I had a very positive experience all along, always involved, always serving, always in some kind of leadership or something, because the church isn't that big. So, but
how racially diverse was your ward in Belgium? Were you in Brussels?
I was in Brussels. Okay. Yes, I was in Brussels in the main stake building, and our church has always been very diverse. I mean, just because I think like immigrants and people from like other nationalities in Belgium are usually more drawn to the gospel, to accept the gospel, than the natives, I would say. So yes, it was always very diverse in our ward.
So percentage of people of color in your ward growing up, approximately like 10%?
Maybe 10%. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, so 1 out of 10.
Between 5% and 10%.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And so it's a French-speaking ward?
It was a French-speaking ward, yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you served in the Callings Beehive, you know?
Yes.
Laurel, yes. Miami.
Yes. Yeah, all that.
President.
Yes.
Yeah.
It wasn't too hard. I mean, there wasn't a lot of people to go.
Did it have a vibrant youth program, or
they did
few kids?
It was few kids, but we were, you know, for the most part, we were very involved. I mean, a lot of people left, you know, like, but there was a core that was always there and that, you know, thrive and did well. And, you know, I'm still in touch with like two or three of my friends that I grew up with in the church. It wasn't big class. I mean, if we were five in a class, that would be great, you know.
And that would not be just your age, but like all the youth?
No, that would be my age. Okay, like, I think each class would have about 4 to 5 people in it.
And would you have had any of the stereotypical kind of U.S. youth experiences, like dances, ward dances, stake dances,
yes,
regional dances?
Yes, we did.
You did?
Yes.
What kind of music would you dance to?
Well, I think it was a little bit more liberal over there, just because we don't speak English and we don't always know what the song says. So if you like the beat and it's not, you know, that clean, well, we don't know.
Okay.
as long as it's not, you know, overtly like F word everywhere, or, you know, like, but if the theme isn't especially good, but the rhythm is good, like, we would just listen to it and dance on it. So
was it mostly European music?
No, most English. I mean,
like
a little
Michael
bit
Jackson,
of both. Yes, yes. I mean, top 40s, you know, that makes it throughout the world. Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So, and any temple trips or youth conferences?
Absolutely.
Or?
And I participated in all of them, and it was great. Like, we would go to the Frankfurt Temple because that was the closest. So when we went to the temple, it was like a 3-day or 4-day affair. So we all go and we stay there and we sleep in the host, the guest house that they have attached to the temple. And you can go from the guest house to the temple without having to go outside. And so it's really, you're in white all the time, and it's really like you're in heaven, right? Mm. You're like floating in your white dresses, and it was great. Like, I loved it, and it was always like super spiritual for me, like testimony builder, you know, like everyone's so nice, and it's just, you know, you cut off yourself from the world, and just, you know, it was great. Like, I really enjoyed it.
What about seminary?
We did seminary, so we would just study during the week and then go on Friday and discuss, you know, what we had studied during the week. So that's how it happened. So, and I was very good about doing it. I mean, I was like a first row kind of the, yeah, I was really into it very much.
And you did all 4 years of seminary?
I did all 4 years and then I went to institute, but I don't think I did all 4 years of institute. I did a couple of years.
Okay.
Yeah.
What about dating in high school?
Dating in high school. So I don't think I ever dated. No, that's not true. I dated one person in the church, but all of the other people I dated were outside of the church.
So you dated non-members?
Oh, yeah.
That's a little sketch.
Yeah, I don't know. That's, I don't know.
That's probably, no, is that just the difference between US
yeah,
and Europe?
Yeah, and yeah, and we don't really date. Like, you just have a boyfriend or a girlfriend. Like, we don't do dates.
Oh, really? It's just like a title.
Yeah, yeah. You just go out with someone and you stick with that one, like, person.
Okay.
That's kind of how we do it. Like, okay. The dating thing is very, it's a very American concept.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. What about law of chastity? How was that taught? How did you experience law of chastity kind of stuff in high school?
Okay, so it's the same teachings, I think, as anywhere else. But the one I remember that I was taught was the flower. You know, you're this beautiful rose, and you want to be this beautiful fresh rose when you get married. You don't want to be a, how you say it?
Mangled,
yeah.
Mangy,
you know, when wilted, there you go, that's the word. you don't want to be a wilted rose. And I actually really hooked on to that idea. Like, I'm like, yes, that's what I want to be. I want to be a beautiful rose. And I remember I was kind of even bragging about that with my non-members friends, because I was one of those super like motivated, like missionary like kind of person. Like, as a youth, as a teenager, I would go out with missionaries and teach with them, you know, because I was like, I don't know, I was just so excited. And for me, it was like, the gospel is true and I need to share it. And, you know, I would stand on the street with them and, you know, talk about it. I would go and sing at Christmas time, you know, in the middle of the square in Brussels. They have like this beautiful square. And I would just be there. And even with my friends, any opportunity I had to like give them a Book of Mormon or bring them to church. I mean, all of my friends from high school who were close to me have stepped foot in the church at some point or another. I mean, they didn't join a church. Some of them, a couple of them did, but and left. But yes, I was really very missionary minded.
And would you have experienced the word of wisdom the same way that maybe someone in the States would have? Was it different in any way?
I didn't drink or smoke or anything like that, but I did taste, you know, like my family was a member. Like, even I remember being very little and like we had parties and at my uncle and aunt's house, and I would just go and like taste people's glasses because they were just there and... You know, like they would just be talking and I'm like, oh, I wonder what that is. So, but I never got into drinking or anything like that. So, but I cannot say I never tasted it. I mean, you eat a chocolate and you will have alcohol in it, you know, right. Over there. Like at some point or another, you will have tasted alcohol in your, even in your dessert or whatever, you right. know.
Okay.
So, but to come back to the law of chastity, like I dated a lot of people, I think, but I knew my limits. So... yeah, like I didn't break the law of chastity or anything like that. And I was kind of bragging to my friends at school that I will be, you know, a virgin until I'm married. And they were like, what? You're crazy. Like for Europeans, that's not even a realistic concept. Like they just see that as kind of weird. But for me, it was like my badge of honor, which now I'm like, yeah, but.
Cool. Okay. Any other important differences between growing up as a youth in, you know, Belgium or in Europe in, you know, in the 1990s?
1990s, yeah.
Versus what you understand the experience to be here. Or would you say it was very kind of Americanized?
No, it's not at all American. I mean, the church a little bit, yes. Are you talking about the church?
Yeah,
the
church, okay, yeah. Members? Your experiences,
yes,
in the church.
Yes, as a member, okay. Yes, it's very much Americanized, but you still have the culture that surrounds you. So I think exposure to, I went to Catholic schools all growing up. So I went to Catholic churches and, you know, talk to nuns and people who are Catholic. I mean, we had there's a big majority, minority of Muslim people in Belgium. And I had good friends, close friends that were Muslim. And we talked, you know, about the Quran and, you know, what they believe, what we believe. So very open. Also people from other faith, you know, like I've always been aware of other people's faith and very respectful and trying to understand, you know, where they're coming from. So as much as I was sure of where I stood, I was very open to listening to what other people had to say about their faith. And
okay.
Yes.
Was your mom super strict?
She wanted to be, but she's very conservative. But at the same time, I don't know. Oh, I guess I wasn't a child who pushed boundaries too much, so we didn't really have conflict. With my sister, it's a different story. She was an independent mind from the get-go, and she just, you know, she's a year and a half older than me, so we grew up together in the church, but came teenage years, she just asserted herself, and she's like, I'm not going to have anything imposed on me, and this is not how I feel, and she just kind of went her own.
You were the good girl.
I was the good girl. Well, yeah. Picture. Yeah. No, but I was really trying to be. It wasn't that I was doing bad things and then No, I was trying to be that Mormon girl that, you know, is just straight laced, you know.
Now, when your mother joined the church, it was after the priesthood ban had been lifted.
Correct.
So was she and were you aware of the priesthood ban growing up?
Not at all. I learned about it later, maybe probably in my teenage years.
Okay.
And my mother also, like, a few years later. But,
wow. Okay, so in the 90s.
It just wasn't taught. I mean, and also at that point, you know, yes, there is no internet, but the missionaries and the church are really saying that, you know, don't go and read anything on the outside because it's going to be all anti, it's all going to be against us. So do not read anything. And if people give you stuff, don't read it. So, and we follow that. I follow that for the longest time, you know, like I'm just not going to touch it. I'm not going to look at it. And my mom, she's not really a researcher or anything. So it was easy for her to just stick to the scriptures and the church manuals, you know?
Okay.
So that wasn't an issue. And at some point we hear about it, but then it's like, yes, it happened in the past and it's not like that anymore. So we're not going to make a big issue about this, right?
So you didn't go, what the?
Well, no, because I didn't really, it was kind of hearsay. So I knew it happened, but I hadn't read anything about it. So it's just, it happened. The church used to not give the priesthood to the black people. But it wasn't no expansion. And so it was just like it happened, but it's not like that anymore. So I kind of went on with my life. You know, it didn't bother me. There was nothing happening at church that would make me feel uncomfortable wanting to look into it. Or so I just kind of set it aside.
So from a racial perspective, you didn't feel mistreated or you didn't experience racism?
No, not at all.
In your lived experience in Belgium?
Not at all. Not here, not in Belgium, not here in the U.S. I've never felt like racism, like, you know, people may have thought stuff, but I don't really care about that. But, like, not overtly, you know, I've never lived any experience. Like, I've heard other people have.
Okay.
Yes, maybe when we talk about the marriage time, I can bring that up again a little bit.
But, okay, yeah. All right, so You get called on a mission.
I do.
Was that hard to make that decision to go on a mission or?
No, I always wanted to go on a mission. That, you know, what happened with me is like the way I was kind of brought up with my church and, you know, it's like I had my life just all planned. So I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this. And it's all planned out and the mission is part of it. And then I will go to BYU. I knew I would go to BYU. I didn't speak English. I had never stepped foot in the U.S., but I wanted to go to BYU.
Your English is crazy good for not having learned English before college.
No, I learned English at 18 years old.
That's crazy.
I did a cultural exchange program in D.C., and that's where I learned it.
Okay.
In that year.
Before your mission?
Before my mission, yes.
Wow. So you learned English in a year?
Pretty much.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. And so you got your call. How old were you when you got your call?
21.
21?
Yep.
Okay. And you got called to?
Temple Square.
Temple Square in Salt Lake City,
in
Utah.
Salt Lake City.
Tell us about that. Let's dive into that. I've heard that's a tricky mission in some ways. Interesting, but tricky.
Yes, yes. So when I thought they would send me to like Africa or something, you know, exotic like that. And I was happy because I was going to see a lot of the friends, you know, the returned missionaries who had served in Belgium. My family was really close to the missionaries since my mom was converted. She just loved the missionaries. We had them over, you know, every Sunday, you know, for dinner, and I was always out with them. So I was excited at the thought of seeing a lot of them coming to Salt Lake. Also because I had gone out with them so much, I wasn't afraid of, you know, talking about my faith and sharing, and, you know, that wasn't intimidating to me. In fact, I did not anticipate what kind of struggles I would have in Salt Lake. To me, it was like, oh, that's going to be such an easy mission because people come to you and because they want to know. You don't go out to seek people out, but you have all these hundreds of people coming and asking, you know, what you're about. And so I'm like, that's going to be so easy, you know, but, you know, it wasn't easy. It was easy to share the gospel, but I did have my struggles, in the mission. The first one being, okay, there were like three blows. I call them like the three blows of my mission.
Okay, wait.
Yes.
What were the best things about it, working on Temple Square?
The best thing about working on Temple Square is like you are traveling around the world without having to pay for it. Being associated with sisters from all over the world, learning about their culture, eating different foods, hearing and learning different languages. It's beautiful. It's a beautiful experience. And because you live in those quarters, those apartments, and because we don't go out, when we transfer, we don't go out because Temple Square is our mission. So every month you have a new companion or you move apartments. And so it's like this musical apartment thing that we play, but we are always around each other. So we really get to know each other in a level, I think, that doesn't happen in the field so much. I mean, maybe with your companion for like several months, but we know each other throughout our mission until you transfer out or you go serve in the field. You know, we have that 4-month period in the field. So it's a beautiful thing.
So you serve
thing.
4 months in the missionary field?
Yes, outside of Temple Square.
Beginning, middle, or end?
It's usually in the middle, in the winter time, right? When it's cold and there is not so many visitors, then a good portion of the mission, maybe like a third of the mission, goes out.
Where'd you go?
I went to the Oregon-Portland mission.
Really?
Yes. And mostly I was in Vancouver, Washington.
Nice.
Very nice. Very beautiful.
That's a great area.
It's beautiful.
That's gorgeous. Southern Washington, right?
Yes.
Right on the border, Oregon border.
Correct. Yes, it's right in the border.
Beautiful area.
It's beautiful. Yeah. It rained the whole 3 months I was there. Yeah. But it was fantastic. I mean, we were on bikes,
yeah,
and dresses and rain gears and dressing and, you know, in the rain. It was pretty funny, but it's, yeah, not something I would do now, but I cherish the memories. It was beautiful. Yeah.
I've heard that, and this is just hearsay, that the Temple Square mission has the most eating disorders of any sort of mission in the world. That there's, and this is just one person's perspective, that there was a lot of competitiveness and focus on appearance that this person said maybe wasn't the most healthy. I'm not trying to dig for dirt.
Yeah.
I'm curious if that was your experience.
It wasn't really my experience. Struggle there was, but I don't recall that that was a specific issue. At least at the time I was there, there may have been one or two sisters struggling with things, but that was an issue. What I noticed more, I was in leadership on my mission also, because it's a sister's mission. We do everything the elders do. You have district leaders, own leader, APs, and, you know, we do that.
As sister missionaries?
As sister missionaries,
really?
Yes.
Okay.
This is why I've never really felt the, you know, anti-feminist, yeah. you know, whatever. Like, I've always felt empowered as a woman in the church, because I did serve in leadership position. Even at the MTC, it was like the coordinating sister working with, you know, and then on Temple Square I trained a couple of times, and then I was assistant to the president.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep.
So you didn't feel like it was an unhealthy culture between the sister missionaries? You felt
no,
like?
No, I mean, you may have a little bit of, you know, appearance issue or insecurities, but that I think is just women in general.
Perfect.
I don't think it's Temple Square. I think there was a lot of love, a lot of support. There may have been a few. I mean, of course, there were some fights and a lot of, you know, when you go on your mission and you really are faced to yourself, you're forced to dig into yourself, and you're trying to be this perfect person. You realize that you have all these challenges and you have to work through it. And for a lot of sisters, it brings back maybe some trauma that they might have been in the past, because they're really digging inside. And so there has been sisters, I mean, I've had companions who'd struggle more psychologically, because you just have to be honest with how you feel. And, you know, and so if there is something that hasn't been resolved, it usually pops up. And I hear that it happens also in regular missions, because
right.
you're just so, I mean, you have to think about who you want to become, who you are. You want to be, you know, honest with, you know, being this disciple of Christ. And it can be a forced psychotherapy sometimes, where and sometimes you're not prepared for it, and it just kind of blows up in your face. So I've seen sisters struggle with that.
So the traditional, you know, Mormon missionary experience is to have this pool of investigators and to track, and then
yep.
to find some investigators you can teach, and then eventually bring some into the waters of baptism. Do sister missionaries in Temple Square get any of that, or something like that, well, other than when they're in?
Yes, that's why we go to the field, to have that experience. But on Temple Square, mostly we tell people about the basics of what who we are, what we believe. Since we're in Salt Lake, and they have, Temple Square has the pioneers, has Joseph Smith, has the temple, we don't have like a set of discussion. We basically take a little bit of all the discussion in one meeting with the visitors. So it's usually a 45 minutes to 1 hour tour that we give them. And we tell them a little bit about how the pioneers got into the valley and how they got settled, and how Joseph Smith, you know, founded the church. And so we talk about the temple, that we get married in the temple. We talk a little bit about everything. You know, we talk about prophets, because the tabernacle is there, and apostles. At the time when I served, General Conference was still happening in the tabernacle, and they were building the new conference center. I mean, the conference center now. So we get to talk to people about just a little bit of everything. And they ask us questions, whatever they want, and we need to just kind of be prepared to answer their questions. So you have everything thrown at you, including all the anti. And one of my first kind of shocking experience was shortly after I left the MTC, went and started on Temple Square. There was the Baptist convention. I don't know if you remember that, like back in 98, I believe. Yes, 98. And they came in the thousands, basically to tell us that we were wrong, that we needed to repent. And it was quite overwhelming, because they would come in like groups and, you know, kind of surround us and start asking all these tricky questions. And we had been instructed not to argue with them, you know, not to get in a fight. Like, if, you know, if we could answer some questions, that was fine. But if we saw that they really wanted to kind of corner us, then we needed to step away, just bear your testimony and walk away, you know, wish them well. And, you know, but it was quite interesting, because for me, who's from Europe and churches are not that prominent, like Baptist church, and they're not, you don't really see them. It was really a spiritual and a cultural experience for me to come across, you know, evangelists and people who would ask me to like, kneel down now and pray with us, you know? I'm like, okay,
right.
Let's hold hands and kneel right here and ask the Lord. And I'm like, okay.
Sure.
So.
But one thing I'm just trying to get at is you don't get the sense of like taking someone into the waters of baptism as a Temple Square missionary, or do you?
We, because people are passing through, we try to invite, but we invite them at the end of each tour to tell us how they felt, how was the experience, and then leave their information for wherever they're from, and we get those referrals, if you will, that we send them to the mission where they belong, back home, to their home. So that goes all over the world, all over the U.S., all over the world. And we just hope that they will continue on, that the missionaries will pick up the referral, go and see them, and continue on with them.
But would you ever hear that someone did it again?
Very rarely. Occasionally, but very rarely do we hear back. And that's the hardest part, I think, of that mission, is that you don't see the result. You don't see the fruits of your labor. It's a seed. We call it like you planting seeds and hope that they will, you know, grow wherever they are. So,
now, did you bump into general authorities while you were...
All the time.
Do you have any stories or fun stories about that?
Yes, I mean, where do I start? Like, we lived like behind Temple Square in apartments on like Main Street or State Street, I can't remember, which was a block away, not even from where, you know, those pink apartments where President Hinckley used to live, and there was, I think, Elder Faust in those apartments. And so, yes, we would run into them because they would go to the church office building. So we'd just stop and they'd talk to us, super nice all the time. Elder Perry was super nice all the time. And Elder Faust was a great man. I met him before in Europe, but just very genuine. And then during general conference, they would go underneath the tabernacle, the old one where they used to have conference, and ride with their little golf carts. And we would be down there because there is the referral center, and we would just see them. Like, we would just, you know, say hi, you know, and talk to them sometimes. And so that was a very common thing to just see them and exchange a few words. And it was very pleasant most of the time.
Did you ever have the chance to get to know any of them or spend any significant time?
Not on the mission. Okay. Not on the mission.
Okay.
Before and after, but not on the mission, yeah.
Okay, last question before we jump into the three hard things. Mm-hmm. How would you have described sort of how your testimony was rooted up until your mission? Like, had you had spiritual experiences? Mm-hmm. What was your testimony based on, and what did it mean to you?
Mm-hmm. I've always considered myself as having a very strong testimony. Like, I received my first Book of Mormon when I was 8 years old, at my baptism, like my own Book of Mormon. And I think I read it then. I read the whole thing then when I was eight, and I marked it, and, you know, and I loved it. And I loved the scriptures, and I felt very close to God and to Christ. And I felt like the scripture spoke to me and answered all my questions. And yes, and I had a very vibrant testimony, and that I was happy to share. And I went with that on my mission, and I was, you know, super motivated.
Had you had those moments where you asked if it was true or wanted a witness and then felt like you received a witness?
Yeah, I don't know. Like, it kind of feels like I've always known. And so it was just always there, and I would feel the spirit strongly. And I don't know if I was overly emotional person or something, but I was just I feel like in touch with maybe other people in the spirit, or like when I read, I felt what I read, and I'm like, you know, it's like, I can say that I felt it very much, like, and I felt like I had received answer, that I believed the church was true, and, you know, the only one and true church on the face of the earth. And yes, I believed all that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So tell us about the three hard things.
So the three hard things that happened on my mission, now I can only remember two, but so the first one was the Baptist Convention. That was a bit hard because they would come up with things that I had never heard before, like really test us on, like, you know, like, is God like three different beings or one? And I mean, they were just challenging, you know, the things that I thought I knew so well, and I didn't know how to explain them very well. And so that was challenging for me to have, you know, all these people trying to prove me wrong and not feeling very prepared to answer their questions. And all I could do was just bear my testimony and tell them I knew it was true. And so that was one. The second, which is, I'm telling you in order that it happened, but the second, which is actually the hardest thing that happened on mission, is that one of my brother passed away. And that was very,
one
very
of your
difficult.
Three older brothers.
One of my three older brothers, okay, passed away, the youngest of the three.
Okay.
And
so you were closest to him, other than your sister.
Excuse me?
In age. You were closest in,
yes,
age.
Yes, yes. Yes. And I knew he was very depressed and struggled with drugs before I left on my mission. But he came to my farewell, and his wife at the time came too. And they had told me, well, she had told me that he was going to a recovery center and that he was going to be taken care of. So I left with that thought that he was going to be taken care of. And so when I learned, you know, that he passed away, it was a really shocking for me and very, very difficult, because at that point, I have to decide, what do I do? Do I stay? Do I leave? You know, and my first impression is I need to leave right this minute. You know, my sister calls and, you know, it's just this really horrible thing. And I'm like, I need to be with my nieces and nephews. I can't, this is all, because up to then, you know, the mission is just easy and kind of nice. And like, I'm having a good time here, but no, it's time to go back to real life and be there for those who need me most. And my first reaction was, I need to go home now. So I go and see my mission president, and he's like, Sister Viegas, I will do whatever you want. If you want to leave this afternoon, I can get you a plane ticket. But before you do that, I would like you to go back to your apartment with your companion and pray and try to find out what the Lord wants you to do. And I do that, and somehow I feel that I need to stay. I feel like, and I'm like, Lord, I really want to go. To go and be with my family. But, I wrote all of this in my journal. And all these scriptures come to my mind, all in a sudden, that, you know, you have to let the dead bury the dead, you know, from the New Testament, that you need to take your cross upon you and follow me. I will take care of them. You know, the love that I have for your family is way bigger than what you can give them. And you need to trust me on that. I mean, those are answers that at the time came to me. And I want to go home, but yet I receive, you know, these answers. And so I end up staying on the mission, which...
You were getting emotional for a second. I'm curious, what was it about that exploration and you know, ambivalence about whether to stay or go home that brought up emotions for you?
Well, it was a hard thing. I mean, my whole family's suffering. My nieces and nephews are in total disarray. I'm not there to help them. It was very difficult. They're not members. My brother's wife and children, and they have no way to understand. They have no way to understand. How is it possible? I'm sorry. Oh, I wasn't planning on this, but how is it possible that our aunt, who loves us so much, is not here to be with us? And I can't explain it to them because they don't really understand the gospel or see it as I see it, and it's rough. It's, how do you explain that? How do you explain that you're not there? Your brother just died. You do not go to the funeral. You're not there for your mom, who's completely in complete disarray. And so, And yet I felt that I was doing the right thing, that if I stayed and served the Lord, he would take care of them better than I could if I were there. And so, and I had several things happen after that, that continued to confirm to me that I did the right thing. Like, I would go to the temple, and then all of a sudden, and I talk about this in my book. I'm writing a memoir, and there's more details to all these stories. But just, I don't really believe in coincidence, and just all these different things happen. My mission president gave me a blessing, saying that, you know, I would feel the presence of angels comforting me. And when I went to the temple, I did feel that. I was really worried about my brother, because he was not a member and he struggled with drugs and that. And for me, it was more like, where is he? Like, is he going to hell, or, you know? And just the comfort that I felt going to the temple, that he's okay. Wherever he's at, don't worry. He's taken care of. He's taken care of. And you don't need to worry about that, you know, and just having that knowledge that, or that assurance, because it's not a knowledge, but that he's fine. He's going to continue on his journey. He's not, you know, it's not over for him, for his spiritual, you know, whatever happens. And just having that, feeling the love of God just in the temple. And like, I remember one time going and doing baptism, you know, on Temple Square, we get to go once a week on our P day to the Salt Lake Temple. So one time we went and we did baptism, and the guy who was like in the baptism found, like, striked a conversation with me and started telling me that he had just lost like a sister and his mother, and, you know, and like right there in the water. And so we exchanged something that at the time was meaningful, because I was just going through this really hard experience there, and I felt like the Lord was kind of sending people in my way that could help me, you know, keep going. And it did change the rest of my mission. I wasn't that confident, and, you know, this is so easy, and, you know, I got this. You know, I continued on with my mission with a much more humble demeanor, and really trying to understand what the gospel was about, and, you know, like, yes, teaching with maybe a depth that wasn't there before.
Yeah, you're going to take your mission a lot more seriously when mm-hmm. you've sacrificed so much to stay. Mm-hmm. So why do you characterize that, the death of your brother, as a significant, I can see why it was a significant event in your mission, mm-hmm. but sort of, did that relate to your testimony in any way, or sort of connect to something that became problematic for you?
Not really. And okay. Today I kind of don't want to go and look back too much into it. I feel like what happened needed to happen at the time, with the knowledge I had and the experiences I had. I don't want to go back and try to undo, you know, what was done. But it was hard, just because, yes, I mean, throughout my mission, I kept suffering. I mean, it's not like the burden was lifted overnight. It kept being hard, knowing that my mother was just in a mourning that would never cease, that continues to this day. That, you know, my nieces and nephews, I mean, just, yes, I just carried that burden with me all along afterwards, so.
Okay. So was there a final thing that was kind of a jarring thing for you on your mission, as far as your testimony goes?
Yes. Which is unrelated, but I kind of say it maybe in chronological order mm-hmm. when it happened. But just learning more about the whole blacks and the priesthood, okay. you know, and the whole, you know, racism and some what the
How'd
leaders
have said.
Do
you remember?
Yes, I remember it very well. We had anti people around Temple Square all the time, and I was just handed a sheet of paper, and it's like, this guy was like, I don't understand why you are part of this church. Like, you're black. I'm like, well, so what? You know, it's like, well, read this, and then, you know, you'll know, like, this church is totally racist, you know? And so I read the stuff. It was just basically quotes from McConkie, Brigham Young, and I had never read that.
And you have them?
Yes. You want me to read
it? Are you comfortable reading them? Or?
I can. I need to turn that on.
Do you remember, like, when you were reading them? Like, do you remember the time you were Were you just looking at the paper? Were you home on the internet?
Remember.
Were you reading a book? Like,
what do you mean?
When
no,
I'm
I received...
trying to think of the time when you like are like looking at these quotes.
Yes, I received them on a piece of paper.
Okay, from someone on the street.
From someone on the street.
And so you're like at ZCMI.
No, I'm on the square. I'm on
the
Temple Square.
Okay.
And he's not allowed. He's not allowed in because he's an anti. So he's behind the gate.
Okay.
And he passes it through me through the gate.
Okay. And your companion is like next to you.
I don't know. Like we're allowed to like roam around on our own, as long as we're like in the square.
Okay.
So it's not like the other mission where you just have to be together all the time. So she may or may not have been there. I don't remember.
Okay.
But I just take that from him and I start reading it, you know, during my break or something, and I'm totally shocked.
Okay, so read what you wrote, what you read, if you're comfortable.
So here is one from Bruce R. McConkie. He says, in a broad general sense, caste systems have their origin in the gospel itself. And when they operate according to the divine decree, the resultant restrictions and segregation are right and proper and have the approval of the Lord. To illustrate, Cain, Ham, and the whole Negro race have been cursed with the black skin, the mark of Cain, so they can be identified as a caste apart, a people with whom the other descendants of Adam should not intermarry. That's one of them.
And what were you thinking when you read that?
I'm like, what the heck? That's BS.
Yeah, okay.
That's what I thought right away. Here is Brigham Young from the Journal of Discourses. Shall I tell you the love of God in regard to the African race? In the white man, if the white man who belongs to the chosen seed mixes his blood with the seed of Cain, the penalty under the law of God is death on the spot. This will always be so.
And
a bit shocking.
And I probably don't need to tell you that your mother was the daughter of a biracial marriage.
Yes, yes, yes. I mean, and it goes like way back in my family. Like we were just a rainbow, like all along and up to this day. Like.
So that quote.
Yeah, like, but I mean, to me, just because of how I've been raised and whatnot, like it was like crazy. Like it was like, I know that's wrong. But I was still shocked that, you know, they could say stuff like that. So what I did, I just went to my mission presence office with those quotes, and I'm like, what is this? And he was very uncomfortable with that. He's like, you know, he didn't believe that either. And he's like, I'm really sorry. This is really, you know, it's not true. And he told me his whole, I love my mission prison, that prison. I was his assistant, and I'm not going to say his name just so, but... he was, I really, really love him. To this day, he's someone I look up to. He's a wonderful man. And he shared with me his experience that he's a convert to the church. And he always struggled with that. The fact that, you know, the priesthood wasn't given to blacks. And he joined the church before the ban was lifted. And he told me that when, you know, they announced on the radio that the ban was lifted, that he just pulled out. He was in his car listening to the radio. He pulled out. Pulled on to the side and just started bawling, just started crying because he was so happy that, you know, this was happening because he never felt comfortable with that. And I think it happened with many people where, you know, they had this dissonance happening, but, you know, they believed the church was true, so they didn't know why, but, you know, they were happy when, I mean, I know some people weren't happy, but I know a lot of people were happy when it happened, so, yeah. Go ahead.
So when you talked to him, did he make you feel better? Did that resolve it for
yes.
you?
Yes, well, it didn't resolve it, but he did make me feel better. And he did tell me, you know what, it's in the past, it's not like this anymore, you know. And the other thing I did was I wrote, because I was upset for a while, it wasn't just, I wrote to Prison Hinckley and just sent him the quotes and sent a letter. At the time, you could just do that. He was right there, so even if you couldn't, I mean, he was just right across the street, so... And I received kind of a politically correct answer that, you know, this, we don't believe that anymore. And just, you know, like scriptures, quotes, this and that. But kind of a, you know, we're so sorry. You know, this is really painful material. And we're sorry that, you know, it hurts you. Like, it wasn't like that. It was just like, we don't believe it anymore. You know, scripture says this and that. And the end, you know. So, Yeah. But then I left it at that. Then I was like, okay, fine. You know, it's behind. Let's leave it behind. And I just went on with it.
So finished your mission.
Yes, I did.
So any other stories from your mission that are important to kind of where we're going in this interview? Or is that...
I had a wonderful mission. Okay. Honestly, like, I can't say that, you know... It wasn't easy always, but it was great. It was a great experience. You know, I don't have any... At that point, I'm really very, you know, I'm following the prophet, I'm following the apostles, I'm doing, you know, what I'm supposed to do, and I'm just following the program here. So Okay. Everything is just working according to plan right now.
So you go to BYU.
Then I go back home. I work for a while in Belgium, and then, yes, I go to BYU. And that's also a good experience for me. Like, I kind of hung out with people who thought a little bit differently, like the liberals, like within my major, political science. Like, we were, I think, the ones who thought a little bit outside of the box. You know, the whole 9/11 happened while I was in college, and the war, and we were against the war. So we had this very interesting debate going on. I studied the Middle East a little bit, so and have lived with Arab people, so I understand their culture. Not that I supported any of what the 9/11 people did, but to put everyone in the same basket was not the right thing, and I didn't think the war was... I mean, we're not going to get into that, but yes.
Okay, yeah. So a good BYU experience.
Yes, I meet my husband.
You didn't experience racism or any problems?
No,
like that?
All the country. I think I had over attention. Like, I received extra attention.
Extra love.
Because
extra...
I was, you know, the minority. It was different, but to me, it was like, you know.
Yeah, okay.
A good thing.
So. Nice to feel special, right?
I felt special.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, so when you met and married your husband, did you ever experience any concern about an interracial marriage at all?
Not me, because in my family, it's happens all the time.
Yeah.
That's how they do it, exactly. So, you know, color skin is like color eyes, color hair, same thing, same difference. You know, I have nephews and nieces, blonde with blue eyes, and my sister, he's the latest who married, and she married a Asian, which we hadn't had in the family yet. But I mean, it's really a rainbow, and which we love, and we were just very open people. So on my side, no, but on my husband's side, that was a new thing, and he was a little bit... he didn't know how that would go.
He's from where?
He was born in Texas, grew up in Arizona. No, he was born in Arizona, sorry, but grew up mostly in Texas. And so, very conservative family, but very open too. Like, my in-laws just embraced me from the get-go, even when they didn't know me. They've always been very kind and, you know, very accepting. Even if I'm like the only black person in the family, like, they're all very, very kind and open. And he was a little bit worried about his grandparents, who would say things, you know, when he was growing up, that were quite a bit racist or a lot. Mm-hmm. So it was a bit of a concern to introduce me to his grandparents. But then, you know, anyone who meets me likes me. No, but they were nice. They were not offended or weird out, or it went really well.
Okay, so you got married. No, yep. No big deal.
Yep.
All right. So when did things start getting difficult in terms of your
of
church experience?
Church.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so we get married, we go and so finish BYU, live in Utah for a little while, then we'll go and live in Houston, and we're both still very, you know, very orthodox, I would say Mormon. So things are going well for me. For my husband, he's a little different. Like, he's always kind of questioned things, and he's a thinker. So, you know, like, I think he's kind of always kind of questioned all along, and a lot of things kind of bothered him, but he wouldn't really talk about it with me. So he kind of trudged along and tried. Like, he really tried to... you know, maybe I'm not praying enough or doing this enough, but he just carries also this huge guilt, like, since forever. that really burdens him. Like, see, for me, it's a different story because we're convert. We came voluntarily. It wasn't our culture around that imposed, you know, our beliefs on us. But for him, that's how he grew up, you know, pioneer ancestry, pretty orthodox upbringing. Things are expected of him. And, you know, even though it's, I don't know, like, it's just those expectations that are there. And yes, the way he tells the story, he just has a lot of guilt all the time that he's not doing enough. He's not doing, you know, all that he should be doing. And so that's how he lives the gospel until things starts getting a little harder. So we're in Houston. Things are still going fine. I mean, we're active in the church and everything. And then we moved to Switzerland. We moved.
About what year?
That is in 2009.
Okay. That we moved. How many children do you have by then?
By then, we have two.
Okay.
We have two kids.
All right. 2009, two kids. You're in Switzerland.
Yes.
Okay.
And there, things start getting a little rougher for him. And for me, because of language. But for him, because he realizes, you know, I stayed in the church mostly because of the culture. And
he says that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And here, I am not, I'm not close to anyone in church. And
was it a German or French speaking?
German.
German speaking to begin, ward.
Yes, German speaking ward.
You don't speak German.
No, but I learned fairly quickly that I was comfortable.
Right.
I mean, at the beginning, it's really hard. But then I learned enough that, you know, that wouldn't have been the reason why I don't
but,
go
but
to
for
church.
Him,
yeah, but for him, yes. It's he doesn't connect with the people very well and the language barrier. And so he kind of, and the motivation, because I think it's around that time that he decides, you know, I'm going to go ahead and read the Book of Mormon. You know, I haven't done it for a long time. I'm going to read it from beginning to end and try to really get into it and understand and, you know, really figure out how do I feel about this? Like, you know, where do I stand? And as he reads, and he tells me this later, he doesn't really tell me when he's doing it, you know, but he starts seeing discrepancies that really start playing with his mind. And it's like, you know, like there wasn't horses and this wasn't there. And that doesn't make sense. And because he's a researcher and he doesn't take things just, you know, for granted or for what they were. It's like, well, that really... And it's not like he had read something that made him go and look for, you know, what's wrong in here. He just came out on his own with all these things, finding all these discrepancies and, you know, anyways, he saw things that really bothered him. And it's like, I don't think I can believe that this is historically, you know, what it says it is. But he kept that to himself. Like, he didn't tell me. But that's what happened with him. And then he starts slowly kind of detaching himself, you know, getting inactive and whatnot. But so for me, it happens later, like where, you know, it's like I'm going on this journey where I want to kind of find myself. And I don't know if there is like a stage in life, like in your 30s, mid-30s, where you kind of want to kind of rediscover yourself and just be... find your authentic self or whatnot. And I read a lot of books. I read The Road Less Traveled, and it really impacts me in a very profound way where I am kind of constantly doing like psychotherapy on myself. I'm like, you know, so what's going on here? What is it you believe? And, you know, then I read, and this is in 2010-11, I can't remember which year, but I read Escape from Carolyn Jessup, right? And that...
Daughter of Warren Jessup?
Yes.
Prophet of the FLDS Church?
Yes. Okay. Who escapes. And for the first time in my life, I find out who the FLDS really are, Fundamentalist Latter-day Saints. Like, I had heard of them. I had heard of the RLDS and this and that, but I never really looked at who these people are. So I read this book. I'm totally floored that first of all they exist. I mean, the way they do, that they're capable of carrying on with such appalling ways of abused and manipulative. And I'm like, how is anyone not seeing this and not doing anything about this? I'm like, how is this possible? And I admire her for getting out of there on her own after generations of being there. I mean, that's all she's ever known until she goes to college, gets smarter, and realizes this is wrong. I mean, you go to college or you learn how to think. To me, it's not just about going to college, but it's learning how to think and freeing your mind. You know, let it understand things the way, you know, it should be. So she gets out of there with her, whatever, 8 kids or 10 kids. I mean, a total hero. So that's one thing, just her resilience. But then I was a little bit shocked by a lot of things that I found in that community that resembled so much what I was seeing in our community. And at that point, you know, I remember posting on Facebook, like, you guys, everybody has to read that book and really find out who these people are, because they are closer to like the original church than we are. And some of the abusive situations there are happening here in the mainstream. And if we don't look at it, I mean, it will perpetuate or, you know, go worse. I don't know. But I have seen like priesthood abuse and, you know, mistreatment of women. It's not that it's rampant, but it's happening. And we need to just look at what's happening there in order not to do the same. And to me, that was like the first. And I was also upset with the fact that all these, like, FLDS refugees, you know, who are kicked out of their communities and just, like, wandering on the road and nobody's helping them. It's like, and this is happening in Utah, like, the state where my church, my one and only true church is, and nobody's doing anything. It's like, I believe my church is, like, ultra-wealthy. Not just wealthy. Ultra-wealthy. Mm. How come there isn't, like, a shelter somewhere for these kids? Because they are a part of us. Like, you may treat them like they're these weirdos that we have nothing to do with, but I'm sorry, they're your cousins. They're your family. Like, whether you like it or not, they're your family. And the simple fact that I had never heard of like a shelter. Well, I learned about some later, but not that our church created, like just good people out there that have a good heart. But that just kind of destroyed me at the time. Like, I was really upset with the institution, with our institution, for not helping these kids. Mm-hmm. Who are totally clueless when they come out of that, you know? So anyway, so that's where it started a little bit, where I'm like, I don't know. Okay. I'm not like 100% agreeing anymore, you know, with... But it's like these things, you know, you hear about, at least in the people who have had crisis of faith, you hear about the shelf or the dam, you know, like you have all these little things that bother you, but you put them away, you put them away, you put them away, or you try to like patch the holes until it doesn't go anymore. And then it just, you know, the flood goes on. So this is happening. And then my husband is also, I mean, continues on his journey where he's like much further. Like, he has this colleague at work who is just fascinated by the fact that he's a Mormon and is, like, you know, wanting to know everything about him and, you know, kind of reading about Mormons and always asking questions. And then one time he comes and he's like, oh, did you know Joseph Smith translated the Book of Mormon with a hat and a stone? And my husband's like, nah, that didn't happen like that. It's like, yeah, yeah. And he's like, no. And then he goes, does his research and find out, yeah, it's true. And that kind of made him mad. He's like, how do I not know that? How do I have to find out from like some external source that this is how it happened? You know, and he's, you know, for me, I grew up in Europe. I don't have pioneer ancestry. We don't tell these pioneer stories around the table because that's just not my thing. I mean, our thing. But for him, who is from pioneer ancestry, should know this stuff. I mean, it's pretty basic, you know, like, and the fact that he didn't know really upset him. It's like, what else do I not know? Well, at the same time, rough stone rolling is kind of making its way through, right? I mean, it came out, what, 2008, 2007, something like that?
2005, I
think. Oh, okay. Well, it came, we heard about it later. A friend of his who's, you know, very active in the church, tells him about this book, listen, you should read this and just try to find out a little bit more about the history. And then he reads that and gets really, really upset with the whole polygamy thing. Didn't know Joseph Smith was a polygamist. I didn't know. And it's like, what the, you know, like, what else do we not know? And so just...
And you had read that Jeff's book, and so now you find out Joseph's
yes,
a polygamist.
Yes, and I'm like, these guys are the same. No, I mean, it's like, this is the church, how it was. Like the FLDS,
yeah.
That's kind of how it was. And they're closer, except that I think Joseph Smith was a little bit more... I mean, he was more intelligent. Like, you know, I don't think he was like Warren Jeff. I think it was totally different. Like, I'm not trying to say that, you know. But like, just the way, I mean, the whole polygamy thing, the way they live, you know, it's... So anyways, he finds out all these things that he's like, you know, this is just too much, you know. I need to take a step back and reassess here. And at that point, I haven't read anything yet. And he's just trying to tell me a few things here and there. But I'm like, oh, I don't want to know. Things are fine. You know, I'm just doing my own thing here. And, you know, it's sad because he's going through full-on faith crisis all alone. He doesn't know anything about the communities out there. And it's not someone who like shares his feelings or anything like that. So he's suffering on his own and I'm not there to support him because I don't want to know, you know, it's all anti and it's just, you know, don't rock my boat, you know, like, but again, I'm also someone who reads a lot and like I read that Escape book. And so I'm going also on my journey, but it's not the same as his. So, then, I don't know, I just get into the, always trying to work on myself, see how I can better myself in every way, physically, spiritually. And I read all these books and I, you know, and I come across Brené Brown and I love her stuff and what she says and what, you know, how she presents it. And I'm like, you know, I am totally going to get rid of shame, guilt, fear, you know, that's it. I'm just going to say when I disagree and stop trying to represent always with all these, I guess now I know it's cognitive dissonance, you know, I'm not going to try to live with that. I'm going to really try to, you know, say when I don't agree. And if it's conflicting with my church, then it's just too bad, but I need to be at peace with myself and what I believe. And so from then on, what happens? Oh, just so many things happen. I mean, there is probate, which I hear about later. And, you know, there is the Romney, you know, running for president. I mean, just the Mormon, you know, moment, like the spotlights, which kind of forces you to look at, you know, what's happening. And, you know, so here you have the historical stuff on one side, and then you have, you know, what's happening today. And it's kind of happening at the same time, which it's a lot of stuff to juggle, you know, trying to understand the history and trying to see, you know, do I agree or not with what's happening here now today with the whole gay issue. And how does that happen? Well, to go back a little bit, my sister-in-law who's came out as a lesbian a year before we moved. So we're going back in time a little bit here. And I had a really hard time with that. I had a really, not because she's gay, but just because of the whole situation. She was married, had four kids. And my reaction is just really awful. Like, I literally don't talk to her for like a few years. As before, we were really close. And shared everything. I mean, we love them. We would have given our kids to them if we died to be adopted. She's an excellent mother, still is. But this whole thing just kind of blows up in the family. And I am facing my own feeling about the whole issue and realize I'm really not that open. And I'm kind of aligning, really. You know, this is not what God wants and this and that. Until, what happened? What happens? I don't know. And I have other friends who are gay. And I know they are. They haven't opened up to me. But and we're friends. Like, I haven't, you know, judged them or, like, told them off or anything like that. But I realized I really do not understand the gay issue. I do not. I know I have my position because that's the position my church has, and that's the position I grew up with. And at some point, I ask myself, I guess, what do you even know about them, you know? And at that point, I come across, you know, I go on the LDS, you know, Mormons and gays websites and things, and I start reading, I start informing myself. And then I listen to the LDS Voices of Hope stories. And that, excuse me, yes. I listened to every single one of those testimonies, and it broke me. It broke me to the ground. It broke me to the ground, the amount of pain that we have inflicted as a church. And that's not even like the bad stuff, because these people on LDS Voices of Hope are hopeful, right? I mean, but just listening to their upbringing and their interaction with the bishops, like giving them some like phony counsels, most of them, literally leading them to live the life and, you know, it just breaks my heart and makes me mirror myself, makes me realize, you know, you haven't been standing in the right place, because we say things sometimes as Orthodox Mormons that are very hurtful and we don't realize it, you know, because we think we're so right in our ways that we just hurt people. We don't even know among us who is struggling with this, and we will say things that will break people. And I probably did too, not intentionally, but this is where everyone has to be informed and to know and to get to know these our gay, you know, brothers and sisters. Get to know them before you form an opinion. And yes, some may say, well, my brother's gay and this and that, but then they hunker down so much on, you know, what the church says, and, you know, they won't take a step back at times. I can't speak for everyone, but I've seen situations where, you know, it's like, no, I will not accept you this way. I mean, we know people have been kicked out. We know people, you know, parents are ashamed, or, you know, and I'm not saying it's not a difficult thing to deal with, even from, you know, an Orthodox Mormon perspective, but getting to know them instead of trying to fix, bring answers, bring, you know, this is how it should be, just shut up for a moment and listen to their stories. See where they're coming from. Because I guarantee you that if you spend the time, you listen to all of these stories and more, and then go talk to them on the street, and you will see how you feel. You know what I mean?
So when did things reach crisis point? How did they go from this to kind of where you were?
Well, from that moment on, I'm an ally.
What year was that about?
This is, when did that happen? Not that long ago, like, 2013, I would say.
Okay, a couple years ago.
So, and that, you know, I'm an ally, like, I don't even know, like, that word. It's just like, you know, I am going to defend these people and speak up and, you know, and then my sister-in-law got married in, 2014, I think?
She was married to a woman?
Yes.
Where?
In Salt Lake. When the law passed, she was one of the first one to...
Oh, okay.
Was that in 2014?
Yeah.
So, she was on the New York Times and everything, like front cover and, you know. And I post that on my Facebook. I'm like, good for you, you know, congratulations. At that point, I still struggle a little. I'm not going to lie. It's not like overnight you're like, oh, I accept this fully. But I'm like, you know what? If this is your happiness, I want you to be happy. And I will deal with my things, my struggles, you know, my feelings, whatever. But I want you to be happy. And a lot of people were offended, of course, that I would pose that. You know, some of my mission friends are like, oh, you know, how do you pose this? And, you know, you oppose the prophet and this and that. And I'm like, well, this is how I feel. I feel like if that's how she's happy, I am going to be happy with her, you know, and that's that, you know. So, yes. But from that time on, I think I'm really seen as like kind of an antagonist, you know. And I will defend, and I'm kind of outspoken. So I'm like, you know what? Don't like it? Go look at someone else's page, you know. So... anyways, that's, you know, what happens with that issue.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So take us to that point. Take us from that point to where you actually feel like you need to write an op-ed in the Salt Lake Tribune.
Whoa. Well, that took a while, actually, because this happened in 2014. Well, then I come across with your podcast somehow. Like, I think I was looking into, what was I looking into? The issues of, like, Mormon and sexuality and this and that. And the Mormons... sex girl, if I don't know what she's called.
Mormon therapist? Natasha Alpha Parker?
Yes, she has like... No, I don't think it's her.
Jennifer Finlayson Fife?
No. No, it wasn't her. It's a therapist, but she deals with couples and their sexuality and talks about... She's on a... I think she went on a Thoughtful Faith on a few...
it's probably focus. Natasha.
You or think?
It's
maybe.
Probably Natasha, yeah.
So anyways, but you I think you have an interview with her mm-hmm. at some point, yes. Mm-hmm. And so I listened to that and I find it very interesting. And I kind of really came across that just because I typed Mormon and sexuality, you know, because there is issues there too. But and I thought it was very interesting what she was saying. And then, you know, I saw that you had more podcasts. You know, I just downloaded the thing on my phone and, you know, and then I looked at, you know, Blacks in the Priesthood and just, I kind of went scroll through and that's how I kind of got, you know, hooked to the Mormon stories. So I liked you. I was like, that's a great guy. He's like so enlightening. And, you know, it's so great that he would just take people from all spectrum, you know, believers, non-believers, ex, and have everyone's point of view and just try to understand where are they coming from, you know, without passing a judgment. Oh, because he's left the church, anything he says has no value anymore. Like, I really do not endorse that. Everyone has their stories. Everyone has something of value to say. And it's not because you're not in the church anymore that, you know, you just shut down and nothing good can come out of your mouth. Like, I don't endorse that. So I listened. And in fact, listening to Mormon stories helped me make sense of all the stuff that I had found out, you know, history that I struggled with, Joseph Smith being a polygamist and, you know, all sorts of things, you know, the way, you know, the Book of Mormon came about and the first vision, multiple versions, you know, like it all kind of came at the same time for me. And I know a lot of people are like, well, you should have done your homework and just, how come you don't know? Well, we are thousands out there, and I think you can testify of that, who found out very recently all of the things. And we were very involved, very active as far as I'm concerned. I did work for the church education system right before my mission. I taught at the MTC. I did EFY for like 9 weeks in a row. I mean, I was really immersed in it. And yes, and I read so much, you know, but it's always the spiritual things and the things that they're willing to give us, right? You are being spoon-fed the right information. And so, no, I never knew none of this stuff. And yes, it makes me feel dumb, absolute, like an absolute idiot who doesn't know her church, you know, when you don't know, like, you know. So anyways, I was very angry at the beginning. I was really, really angry. I was like a child having a tantrum. And I think a lot of my friends did not really understand why I was acting like that. And, you know, while all of a sudden she says all these mean things about the church and the betrayal and this and that. And I'm like, well, that's how it felt for me. It was like the carpet had been pulled, the rug had been pulled under my feet, from under my feet. And my whole foundation was broken under my feet. And yes, I was really upset. I was really upset because here I am giving you my whole heart and soul, standing in the front line, protecting you. I would have like laid down my life to protect my church. And, you know, and here you pull that on me, you know, like, no, I wish you had told me. I wish you had trickled those historical facts down the line. I understand that, you know, presenting it all like, you know, Richard Bushman and Russell and Rowling is a little bit tough, like maybe for the whole of the membership. But they could have been a way to like trickle it down, like within the church manuals. I'm not saying, well, it's an institute. Well, how many people go to institute worldwide? I'm not talking statewide, but worldwide. How many people do institute? Not that many, you know, because like, well, it's in the institute manual. Well, you know, that's a little bit too much of a dig. You know, we have manuals every Sunday. We have lessons. we could have talked about that, you know, and the whole polygamy issue in the end. Yes, of course, for me, it was shocking, you know, that Joseph was a polygamist. I thought he started with Brigham Young, so I got it completely wrong. But then past that point, it's like, okay, he was polygamist. What about the wives? Who are they? Can we talk about them? Are they not important? Do their lives do not matter? Because I've been taught that every soul is important in the eyes of God. I've been taught that you should keep your history, that you should record your history. And I've done that. I've got tons of journals. And I'm like, why is it that their lives weren't important? Why is it that I've only heard about Emma? And what are the names of the others? And who are they? What did they do? It's important to me. They're people. They're not ghosts. So anyways, I struggle with that. So
you found Mormon Stories.
Yep, and started informing myself, yeah, on everything I could.
And was there some boiling point or breaking point that made you write that op-ed?
Oh, yes. Yeah, sorry, I didn't answer your question. Okay, so how did that come about? So, all right, so I listened to all this information. I'm grateful that you're out there sharing that with everyone. You, in my opinion, was very honest about your ups and downs and what, you know, you believe, you don't believe, you question, you know, you have flaws like we all do. You make mistakes. You took the, you know, the whole Mormon story community a little bit too far. You know, people are following you and stuff. You recognize that it went wrong at some point. You recognize that, you know, maybe I shouldn't have taken it that far. And you try to rectify. You try to come back and see if you can make it work. You come with humility saying, here I am, you know, I won't lie to you. I can't say that, you know, I know without a matter of a doubt that, you know, without the shadow of a doubt that the Book of Mormon is true or Joseph Smith the prophet. But I still value what's in the religion. I still value the community and I want to be a part of it. And here they are saying, no, you can't. It's too late. You are out. You've done too much. I don't know what they say that you've done, like why you were, what was the big accusation that you had followers? Is that why?
Apostasy, but
apostasy,
yeah.
For what? For leading people away. So, you know, people are free to choose who they're going to follow, and to accuse you of, I mean, you didn't make them follow you or believe what you said. Just like, I'm not trying to convince anyone here to believe what I believe, to follow me. Like, I don't need a following. This is my journey. This is my spiritual journey. And if people resonate with that, then that's their thing. And now to say that, you know, because they're like, yeah, Julienna, thank you, you know, for what you're saying is bringing a following. I don't understand that, because I'm not trying to create my own church or create my own movement here. I'm just saying how I feel and how I live it. So the fact that they just shun you when you are wanting to come back, because you were right at that point.
I was active up through the...
Until they say you cannot belong anymore. I'm like, you know what? I know, I don't know a lot of things, but I know that's not what Christ would do. That I know. If someone wants to belong, Christ is not going to say no. He's going to say, come, let us work through this. And so to me, no, I'm not going to agree. I'm not going to agree with that. And that was also the tipping point. Same with Kate Kelly, because it kind of happened at the same time. Now with that, it's kind of a different thing. Like, I don't feel as strong, you know, like I don't have that need of having the priesthood or whatnot. But I did try to understand where they were coming from. And I did look at the issues that they were bringing up. And it makes sense. If you look at what is it they are wanting and talking about, and I don't want to expand on that, but, you know, it makes sense, you know, like, and yes, maybe not everyone, every woman should have the priesthood, but yes, it did exist in Joseph Smith's time. Why was it taken away? Do we have an answer to that? So why could it serve us today? Well, your husbands travel a lot. Your kid is sick. Why can't you do an anointing and a blessing on that child? What's wrong with that, wanting to bless? You are in a village. There is only women there. there is no man to be found around. Well, there is no church. There is nothing that can be done without the presence of a man. And that's problematic. And yes, it probably doesn't happen that much. So I'm just giving like a theoretical example here. But a lot of the things that they are saying do make sense. And it's not like this crazy thing that, oh, you know, they just want to the priesthood. And then, you know, I don't know, like this kind of weird ideas as to why they want to. No, the way they went about it, I can't say that I fully endorse and agree that, the you know, having their own meetings and stuff. I mean, I have my reservation on that. But to me, this whole fiasco could have been avoided had the leader said, come on, sisters, let us talk. What is it you want? You know, let us, you know, discuss with you, because they're all faithful women who don't even question, like, you know, the truthfulness of the gospel or anything. They're like all valiant and they want to serve and they want to, you know, they don't even have issues with, except for this one thing. And they could have just said, let us talk. And maybe they did. I don't know. Did they have an audience with the general authorities,
no,
ordain women?
No.
Okay, because maybe I'm not aware of that.
No, they tried.
They could have had an audience and they could have gone back and said, okay, let us pray. This is our job, to ask God, because he's our friend, right? We're so close to him. They could have just gone and prayed about it and even come back and say, you know what, sister, it's not the time. Can you please be patient with us and with God and just go on with, you know, how things are. But they didn't even do that, I don't think.
Nope.
So to me, it's like, you know, you are our leaders. And if there are needs, even if it's like a small little minority, we are a body, aren't we? Like, we're like the body of Christ. If your toe hurt, you're going to look at your toe, at your pinky toe, and fix it. You know, it's not because they're not like the brain, you know? And so they could have just avoided this whole fiasco. And so when this happened and you're excommunicated and they are, I'm like, you know what? Just, I can't endorse this. This is just political here. This is just institutional. And at that point, I separate my faith in God, Christ, and the Holy Ghost from the institution, because this for me will not be touched. I choose to believe. This is my foundation. I choose to believe in God. I choose to believe in Christ. And we have a relationship. And I choose to believe in the Holy Ghost. Now, the institution, gosh, I've got issues, you know? Because if you're not doing what Christ would do, I want to follow Christ. I don't want to follow the prophet or the apostles if they're not following Christ, if they're not loving, if they're not understanding, if they're not, you know, doing the things that Christ did. Christ wasn't going around about judging people and telling you, you go now, you're not doing the right thing, you excommunicate. The only people he didn't like was the hypocrites. That's the only people he had issues with, the hypocrites. And to me, if I don't see you do what he did, I mean, look at Pope Francis, for heaven's sake, going about being Christ-like. And I don't even care if it's PR, like if he's trying to like get a good image, but at least he's doing the right thing. Going on and apologizing for something that happened like centuries ago, you know, it's like, can we take heed, you know? I think we can learn from others. I don't think that we have it all and can't learn from others, you know? Sorry, I don't mean to sound angry here. I'm not, but it is a little bit.
What I hear you saying is that you expect the church that claims to be led by Christ to act Christ-like.
Absolutely. Just that. Because I feel that there's just so much judgment right now. So much judgment and judging. And we need to just, you know, lay down the line and, you know, bring up, just square everyone. And it's like an army more than a church to me. And I'm like, I am no soldier. Like, yes, maybe for Christ, but then to me, I understand that very differently. To me, it's social justice, and you look at who's hurting out there, and you go and you help them. It's not about aligning to some, you know. No, I don't agree with that. So that's just me.
Thank you for joining us today on Mormon Stories Podcast. To discuss this podcast with others, please check us out at mormonstories.org. To keep this podcast alive, please consider a tax-deductible donation today by becoming a monthly subscriber at mormonstories.org. Audio and video for this podcast were provided by Richard Holdman. If you say